Now that we've gathered some background, it's time to extract from that background the key ingredients. Ingredients are the principles, the mechanisms, the facts, the systems, which will form the components and the key aspects from which we'll develop an explanation and build that into our model. What we saw in the previous tutorial is that our sensory signals are actually very noisy. Our optic flow signal, the visual signal, is essentially the same for both of the conditions, and the only motion signal available which reliably tells us that we're moving is in the vestibular system, except it's not particularly reliable. In fact, if we don't integrate the vestibular acceleration signal, we wouldn't know if we're moving or not. This has a lot to do with the fact that in our experiment, participants are moving extremely slowly. Once we integrate this signal, we do see that there are some differences between the self-motion condition and the world motion condition. These differences, however, differ enough on a trial-by-trial basis that it's difficult to see how the participants could reliably distinguish their own self-motion from no motion. The third step in our modeling is to identify the ingredients. One of the easiest ways to think about this is to pull together variables that we think will be needed. These variables will always be the inputs to our model, the outputs, which are usually the data that we want to explain. Here, these are the perceptual judgments that people are making. But we also pull together the ideas, which will link these two and develop an explanation for how the inputs are converted into outputs. We can imagine that our ingredients, which are composed of theory, mechanisms, concepts, and data, are going to be thrown into the model. But remember that we only want to keep the ingredients that will develop something truly tasty. One of the key ingredients is neural denoising. The signals that the brain has available to it are much too noisy to underlie perception, which simply does not fluctuate on a moment-by-moment basis like the signals that we're seeing. From an engineering perspective, denoising can be accomplished through a process called filtering. Filtering constitutes a kind of local averaging across time of a signal to reduce the noise, but that filtering process may also distort the signal slightly, creating biases and changing its temporal characteristics. In this tutorial, we're going to take the simplest possible approach to denoising, taking advantage of the fact that averaging will reduce noise. Here we're taking the simplest approach to denoising using something called a moving average filter. What a moving average filter does is averages the signal over a small segment of time, here shown as three consecutive elements. Think of these numbers as the moment-by-moment value of our neural signals. When we take the mean of these under a window, it will generate a value shown on the right. And as we shift this window, we'll generate a series of values which are smoother and less noisy than before. The reason that they're less noisy has to do with the basic statistical properties of averages. If we have a series of random numbers which have a variance of sigma squared, the average of these numbers will have a variance which is reduced by a factor of 1 over n squared. So in our example on the right, this would be a reduction in variance of 1/9 for a window size of 3. The second ingredient comes from appreciating that the brain has to distinguish when we're stationary from when we're really moving, given that very noisy vestibular signal. When we're not moving, the mean of that vestibular signal might be where this blue line is. On a moment-by-moment basis, that signal is fluctuating such that it would form this red distribution. When we're actually moving, but moving quite slowly, you'd have a different mean centered at this black distribution, and the moment-by-moment value of the motion would again be distributed. To optimally distinguish these, we can use a criterion, a threshold, such that when the vestibular signal is high enough to be above the threshold, our best guess is that we're really moving. And when it's below the threshold, the best guess is that we're not moving. We will implement thresholding for self-motion detection and see how this performance depends on the threshold in the next tutorial.